Hello everybody. In this video, we'll start with a series where we'll take a look at every single extension in the latest version of Inkscape. Extensions are scripts that anyone can code and extend the core functionality of the program. Inkscape comes with about 70 or so built-in extensions, and some of them are really useful and would make a great asset for anyone interested in being more efficient, so I think they are certainly worth a look. I will go one by one and explain what each of them does and how to use them, but I will not gonna go over every single button and option, mainly for the sake of brevity, but also because it's not necessary to be able to use them. Also, I will not gonna go over how to make your own extensions. Let me know in the comments if that's something that you would be interested in. In this part, I'll go over all the extensions in the Arrange, Color, Document, and Export menus. And one final thing, I would like to remind you that I make tutorials on Inkscape every week, so if that's something you're interested in, make sure to subscribe and hit the bell, and also a like would help me a lot. That's all, let's begin. But before starting with the actual extensions, there are a couple of things I would like to address. First, in the Extensions menu, there is an item called Manage Extensions, which will open up a menu where you can see and install even more extensions. These are community made, meaning they are not made by the Inkscape team and could potentially have malicious code, so be warned. All you have to do to install any of them is to select them and click on Install Package, and that's it. One thing to keep in mind is that here you can only see a few, but if you go to the Inkscape download section in the Inkscape site, you'll see the full list. Right now there are close to 250. It would have been really nice if all published extensions show here, but sadly if you want some of them, you'll have to install them manually. I will not go over how to install manually downloaded extensions in this video. There are already tons of tutorials on how to do that, and that's not what this video is about. But let me know in the comments if that's something you will be interested I go over. And second, this can be really important for usability, as we'll see in a minute. Inkscape lets you set up a custom shortcut for each extension. Just go to Preferences, Interface, Keyboard, and here you go to Extensions, and you should see all extensions there ready to be assigned a shortcut. This will make more sense with a particular type of extension. I'll let you know about it when we get to those. Okay, now let's start with the Arrange menu. These two extensions deal with groups and C order. Deep Ungroup will allow you to ungroup deep nested groups. If you have groups within groups within groups, this menu will allow you to ungroup everything automatically without having to go in manually. You can use the menu to specify some options, such as what groups to keep in from the top and bottom, though most of the time you'll want to leave everything as it is. This extension can be useful, but it's nothing that you cannot do better by just selecting the group and hitting Ctrl+Shift+G multiple times until everything is ungrouped. Restack will change the stack order based on the position of the selected objects. This is the first time that we see a menu with a live preview option. Enabling this option will make it so any change that you do on the menu will be shown on the objects in the document. Otherwise, you will have to wait to see what happens when you apply it. So I recommend you to always enable this option when you see it. Anyway, you have two important tabs. Based on position, we'll restack the objects based on the position. Here on Restack Direction, you have a dropdown where you can set the direction, left to right to left, bottom to top, and so on. You have other options, but I don't think they are as useful. The other tab, based on C order, has a single dropdown where you can reverse the order or make it random. If it helps, you can open the Layers and Object dialog and take a look how the order changes with the options set with this extension. This is one of the extensions I find quite useful. It's always a pain to go in and change the C order manually when you have a ton of objects, so keep it in mind for those designs that have a ton of objects overlapping. Let's continue with the color menu. As you may have realized, these extensions deal with color, and there are a ton of them, so instead of doing what I usually do and go one by one from top to bottom, this time I will break the order a bit and group them together according to their functions so they are easier to understand. First, I would like to go over the extensions that have dialogues. These are the ones that have three dots. The other ones do not have a dialogue and are executed immediately, and are heavily related to each other, so I want to leave them for later. Black and white will not do what you think. Funny enough, we'll set the selected shapes to be either full 100% black or full 100% white, depending on the value of the color. You have a threshold input, and depending on the number set and the color of the object, it will set both the fill and stroke color to full black or white. Like with many of these color extensions, it's not that useful for a single object, but if you have hundreds of objects and you need them to be either black or white, depending on the value of their color, it can be exactly what you need. Custom will let you change the color by using some mathematical functions, including variables, multiplications, divisions, sums, and rests. It is used to set colors relative to an already set color, for example to half the amount of red of an object or to duplicate the quantity of green. You have three built-in variables, R, G, and B for red, green, and blue, and you can use mathematical symbols to do some basic operations on them, which will set a new color. You may be thinking that setting colors mathematically is pretty useless, but again, you have to think in terms of setting some general color changes to a ton of objects at once who all may have different base colors. HSL Adjust will adjust the color of the object by changing its hue, saturation, and lightness. The changes are done relative to the already selected object. At 0, 0, 0, there is no change, and from there you shift the values. Being able to shift the colors of an object in real time is super useful. The problem is that this isn't really real time. It always takes a second to make the change, even with the preview button enabled. The interface is also really difficult to use. I wish there was a color wheel or something better to make the changes. Randomize will set a random color value for the hue, saturation, lightness, and opacity. You can set the range with these sliders, set them to 0 to avoid any random change on the value. This extension will also give it a separate colors to the fill and stroke. Replace color will take a color and replace it with another one. With the first tab, you can set the color you want to replace. You should use the dropper here to sample from the color you want to pick. With the second tab, you set the new color. It will not work with gradients unless you pick the exact same color from one of the swatches. In that case, the swatch will be swapped with the new color. One thing I don't think I mentioned is that the UI in the extensions is a bit clunky. If you have the preview button enabled, you will not be able to interact with the document, so you will not be able to sample. Just disable the preview button temporarily, and after sampling you can go back to enable it. At first glance, these extensions may not seem to be that useful, but it is quite interesting when you have a ton of duplicated objects and you would like all of them to change to a new color. And those were all the extensions with dialogues. Let's move on to the other ones. These extensions do not have dialog options and do one quick thing, a quick change in color in this case. And because the change in color will usually be subtle and you may want to repeat them multiple times, they can be a good candidate to use with shortcuts. So keep that in mind when we see the next extensions. This I will group together. Brighter and darker will set the selected object to be brighter or darker. If you look at the HSL color mode, you'll notice that the extension will raise or lower both the hue and saturation slider a bit, so it changes more than just the lightness. How much it changes those sliders depends on the color set, but it's always very subtle. A couple of very important things to know. First, any change you do will also affect the stroke. And second, both also works with the gradients, which is awesome. Desaturate and grayscale will set the object to black and white in different ways. Desaturate will just set the saturation to 0, just like going to the S slider and setting it to 0 there, but worse because the extension also affects the stroke. Grayscale will also remove all saturation, but it will also adjust to maintain the same lightness than before, so it's more useful than desaturate overall, though it also affects the stroke. Both of them work with gradients. Less hue, less light, less saturation, and the opposite ones, more hue, more light, and more saturation, will add or remove just a bit of hue, light, or saturation to the color. You can see it more clearly in the HSL mode, where the hue slider changes in a value of about 20 and about 5 for the saturation and lightness. List all, will output a list with the hexadecimal color value of the fill and stroke of all the selected objects. The hexadecimal value can be set into the RGBA box as a way to copy the exact color. If no object is selected, then the list will show all objects present in the document. This extension is useful to get a list of all the colors present in a large pool of objects, but since you don't get the object name, it's a bit less useful in my opinion. Negative will set the object to its negative colors, really useful, and it keeps the fill and stroke separated. RGB Barrel will shift the colors around, red, green, and blue, so basically it will add full red, then green and blue. A bit of a bizarre extension in my opinion, or perhaps I'm not understanding exactly what it does. Finally, remove green, blue, and red will do just that. Take all the green, blue, or red from the color of the selected objects. The document menu has extensions related to handle some documents and canvas options. DocInfo will show some information related to the document in a text box. Nothing you can't see in the document properties, but still nice to have. DPI 90 to 96 and DPI 96 to 90 will change the page size to fit with the DPA standards, more important for printing than anything. This is yet another extension with no options. I recommend you do not touch this unless you know what it means. Guides Creator is a really cool extension that will create guides automatically for you. These are normal guides, like the ones you pull from the rulers, only that this will follow and divide the page and adjust to its proportions. You have three tabs. The first tab lets you create rectangular guides that will divide the page in rectangles. If you have the guides dropdown set to custom, you can set the columns and rows here with these input boxes, but you also have the option to set a preset based on the golden ratio and the rule of thirds. On the next tab, you can set the diagonal guides that will bisect the angles of the page. You can enable and disable guides from each angle. The margin tab has a lot of interesting presets with different margins. You can also use this dropdown to change the proportions of the margins in the different places. And of course, you can change the amount of columns and rows. All in all, this is a really nice extension with a lot of built-in guides. If you're interested in graphic design for printing, definitely check it out. The Layout submenu has three interesting extensions that are well worth to check out. NApp Layout will create a table of square guides to print multiple illustrations in a page, like stickers. The Page Dimensions tab handles the size and margins of the page. With the size X and size Y, you can change the size of the page itself, and the guides that comes by default will adjust. You can also change the top, bottom, left, and right margins from where the guides will start. The Layout Dimensions will change the dimensions of the guide. Rows and Columns will change the amount of rows and columns. Size X and size Y will change the size of each square. The Marks tab will have some options on what's displayed on each guide, such as if you want a placeholder or if you want some cutting marks or padding guides. This is yet another really useful extension if you want to work doing this kind of printing. Perfect Bound Cover Template will create guides for a perfect bound book. I am not familiar with anything related to the printing process, but for what I can gather, perfect bound is a bookbinding technique, and I'm assuming that this is a guide for making the cover, which requires a thick side, which depends on the amount of pages. This extension lets you input information about the physical dimensions of the book, like the size of the book, the amount of pages and cover thickness, and it sets up the Inkscape page and guides for you. Again, important extension to know. Printing marks will create standard printing marks like page information, color bars, and bleed and crop marks, all fitting with the dimensions of the page. In the Marks tab, you have a lot of checkboxes that lets you enable and disable all the different types of marks. In the Positioning tab, you have the options to set the offset and margins of the marks. Because this extension generates shapes, it does not have the option to preview it. In order to see the changes, you have to apply it. The final extension in the document menu is Process Illustrator SVG, which is used to correctly open any SVG file exported from Adobe Illustrator. If you open the extension, you should see very clear guides on how to use it. Just click on Apply right after opening it, and it should make everything work out. The Export menu contains extensions related to exporting. Export Layer Slices will export all rectangles in a layer as its own separate files. Just put whatever you want to export inside a rectangle of any dimensions. Make sure the layer name matches the name set in Layer with Slices, and set the exporting directory and the DPI. You can also enable icon mode so that you get different versions with different dimensions specified in the size input. Guillotine will let you use guides, the ones that you drag from the rulers, to divide the page area and export the resulting rectangles as different PNG files. Plot has always been disabled for me. I'm assuming it has something to do with the G-code tools extensions that we haven't seen yet, but I still haven't found a way to make it work. Maybe it's something that only works on Linux. Anyway, we are skipping it. Win32 Vector Print is an alternative method for exporting PDF files that may work better with certain type of printers like laser cutters and engravers. If something you exported is not reading correctly as a vector shape, try exporting using this extension. And that was it for now. This video is starting to run a bit long, so we'll continue from where we left off in the next one. For now, don't forget to like and subscribe, and let me know any questions you may have about this video in the comments. Have a great day. Bye.